how cloud is got evaluated, actually, how the cloud computing had started. So basically, cloud computing started. If you take a typical...
What I'm doing, Raja, I'm keeping you, keeping myself on a mute. If okay. There is any question...
Solution came into the picture. Typically, when you go to the 80s or 90s, right, how service-based companies work is there, right? So they used to have a server switching set up in their environment. And what used to happen, right, when any requirement comes or any for like scaling or adding up new hardware or purchasing of new license, new servers and all this stuff. So they need to provide a space for the server, and they need to continuously monitor the server. And they need to, if any physical hardware is required, right, they need to manually plug in and all this stuff, and they'll be having a lot of things to buy and all this stuff. So the cloud is a solution for it, where the company could not like have a physical hardware on their premises. So the cloud services provides you all the physical and necessary needs of your system or anything. So it could be not maintained in your premises. Some X or Y person would be maintaining for you. So what advantage that gets when it's not in your premises is, right, cloud is always like plug and play. When you add any new hardware or software, right, it's a few configuration settings he needs to do. So automatically the hardware and software will be available based on the availability of that service provider which we choose. So what it makes, right, it saves a lot of manual effort for the company, so that it's just in a configuration, so it will not take much time to extend the physical hardware or software of your system. So basically, when you say the hardware and software, right, it always depends upon two types. It's a vertical and horizontal scaling. So what is a vertical scaling is that, for example, you have an 100 GB of hard disk and 2 GB of RAM. And a vertical scaling, right, you're upgrading your system to like 1 TB or to 4 GB or to 12 GB or anything. So basically, there will be two terminologies always you'll be coming across in cloud. One is vertical scaling and horizontal scaling. The vertical scaling, I already explained it, right? Improving or adding your hardware necessities, like extending your hardware and software compatibilities, like RAM, processor speed, and it's coming to the hardware hard disk space. So coming to horizontal scaling, so you can create n number of systems if you want, virtual machines if you want, from the cloud. Easily, like it's just an you'll go to the portal and you'll be just creating the virtual machines, which I'll be talking about it later. And I'll go to the next step of the slide, which is nothing but, so for, if you want to go to any cloud services, right, if you want to choose, there'll be these basic parameters that you're going to choose. Like, based on these parameters, I'm going to decide which service provider of cloud I'm going to use. One is performance. It's nothing but how much amount of the external systems that are, like, how much higher configuration systems that are being available through this provider. Like, max limit of your RAM or like CPU processes that can be provided by the cloud. And the second comes with, whenever, if the hardware and software is not present in your premises, right, the first doubt comes with the security. So how security is my cloud systems, and what are the various security measures that you are going to provide through my provider? And safety and isolation is nothing but it's about the brand that we're going to use, how bigger is it. And availability is nothing but, so if I have deployed an an web application in one of my data centers that are provided by cloud. So the data center may be due to some physical damage or external damage, the data center is down. But our cloud systems would should be able to provide an alternate for that without losing the data. So for the availability, I'll say, I'll try to speak about later in the later slides. So maintainability. Maintainability, it's nothing but how less dependent is depends upon your resources using the that are using the portal, like how easy it's been maintained by your developers, rather than relying with the more numbers that are used to make it work, come from the maintainability for our application. And scalability, I think I already talked about the scalability, right? About the vertical scaling and horizontal scaling, like how much extent that our systems could be upgraded or downgraded kind of thing. Next, coming to the, so as I said, right? So these are the various parameters that we can consider before going to the cloud, right? Let's talk about what Azure does. So Microsoft Azure is nothing but an OS that's built by the Microsoft, which allows you to like create various services that are there. So I'll be talking about the services later part of that. So it allows the developer to consume those services and build applications in various areas, actually. And the second come of reliability is, right, Microsoft provides 99% of reliability, means on the services level, means they would assure you like 99.95% of percentage, right, your data would not be lost if you go to Azure. But what they say is, right, so for each application or for each thing, they ask you to create a two instances which are not in the same geographical location. So based on it, what will be a geographical location and how do you choose geographical location, I'll be talking about that in the later slides. So if you create a two instance for your application, right, then they say like we can provide you 99.95% of reliability. That's the agreement that I'm going to do. So so second come is, so here you can see, maybe it's not clear as of now. So you can see the various data centers that are there across the globe, actually. So it's a pretty outdated slide. So now the data centers would be probably more than you can see here. So, and second thing comes is, right, so you said I'll be providing a cloud service. So how I would pay? Like, for example, you have created like 50 systems for you, for your purpose, but you're no longer using, you're only using two systems for it. So what is, how the Azure billing works is, or any cloud billing works is, pay only when you use. For example, once I created in a system with some X or Y hardware, and I'm like 50 systems, and I'm only using two systems, so you'll be billed only for those two systems, rather than the 50 systems. But here also you need to understand, like, the software and the usage is different. When you create a 50 systems, right, or using some Windows like Windows 12 server, but you need to pay the license cost for each and server that you've been set up using that OS. But the physical hardware and the usage will be charged only based on the usage, not on the number of creations that you created across the systems. Like 50 systems I created, but I'm currently using only two systems. So the billing would be done only for the two systems rather than 50 systems. So every cloud service also works in this base system, like pay for what did you use kind of thing, not that you're owning purpose. And coming to the, as I said, cloud, right? The basic terminologies of clouds are segregated into four different categories. The public cloud is nothing but, as I showed you, all the data centers which are across, right? So the public clouds are being typically like what you have a public Azure portal, where we'll be having in a different data centers with individual users. So the data is maintained by the third party guy. It's nothing but our Azure people. A private cloud is nothing but, so as I said, Azure is nothing but one operating system. So even Microsoft provides a WAP, which is nothing but a private cloud OS, where you can install that in your systems, and but it will be not providing all the service providers that are there in Azure, but you need to maintain your in-premises, and your people needs to be providing all the physical hardware and rest of the things. So if you take as you're working in New Zealand, right? So there are certain banks, they don't prefer to have their user-sensitive data in public clouds. Even in US and these kinds of states, right? Their government would not allow you to save the information, sensitive information like SSN or credit card details in the public clouds. There are very strict rules saying that it should be saved in in-premises. So those kind of criteria usually leads to the private cloud, which is maintained by Azanes, the water company which is handling those information, rather than putting that information in third-party services like cloud, Azure, or anything. And comes to the community cloud. Community cloud is nothing but, it's like in a small group of people are created in our services, which is only consumed by that particular community. And the fourth and last comes the hybrid cloud. The hybrid cloud is nothing but a combination of private cloud and public cloud or community cloud. So what does it do in a hybrid cloud is, few of the services would be consumed from the public and few of the services would be there in private premises, which is in premises of that company. So we call this service, this kind of services of, called as hybrid cloud. If you take an Azure, right, as I said, for private cloud, there is a called WAP. They call this WAP actually. And public cloud is called Azure Portal, Azure, or you can say. So in Azure, in WAP also, we can configure few services which are consumed by the public cloud using Azure actually. So coming to the second part, so they are internally, all the cloud services are divided into three major sectors actually. One is infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and software as a service. If you see the green color here, it's right, the green color indicates that this part is maintained by the service provider, and other, the blue color items are handled by you. For example, if you have a private cloud, right, which would be on premises, so everything you need to handle by yourself. When you say an infrastructure of the service, right, so it's nothing but you decide your physical hardware, software, and how do you build your system. Nothing but a typical virtual machine that we have. So when the admin guy comes, right, he'll be deciding how much amount of hard disk that I need to provide, how much amount of RAM I need to keep, and how much, what would the OS that we have. So those kind of services would be like infrastructure of a service in a cloud provider. Coming a platform as a service, right, platform as a service are nothing but, they would provide an outputs of from an SDK, which I'll be talking about that later, or using web APIs. So using those services, we are going to build our application. So, but you'll be not able to decide what kind of hardware I'm going to do that, because Microsoft itself creates those kind of hardware and gives you as in a services, just you'll be only going to consume those services. Software as a service is nothing but typically if you have, right, if you take Microsoft, it has Office 365 and SharePoint and etc. And those will be a typical software. You are going to having a license for that software and you'll be consuming that software. But you'll be not deciding where the information would be saving, like all my details would be saving kind of thing, and like that. So it's like completely maintained by the cloud providers, and you'll be only consuming that software kind of thing. It's nothing but for taken on Azure. So there'll be basically two major things. As I said before, right, Office 365. Office 365, you can just use the apps of Office 365. But you'll be not decided where our file or anything would be saved. So those kind of information are handled by cloud team if it comes to software as a service. So as you can see, the next level, how it comes. So these are the level of access when you decide, when you have on a different levels, like software as a service, hosting and everything would be done by them. So if you come to a past, you can decide what operating system that you're going to use and all the things, and infrastructure as a service, net, what is the like configurations and everything that I could do using that. So if you go to taken a typical Azure portal, right, so it provides, as I said, right, majorly platform as a service and infrastructure as a service. So these are the categories that are present for the different platform services, like as you can see. So the for the platform as a service, right, these are the things like hosting a web application, creating a SQL server, or Visual Studio, and any data analytic tools are things. As a software of the background, it would be decided by Azure, but not by you. But if you go to infrastructure as a service, like as I already said, like creating a virtual machine and Azure file storage and virtual network and load balancer, here you'll be able to choose the operating system and how your system should be behaving kind of thing. So as I said, right, when you want to use a platform as a service, right, so there should be some framework which is built by the Microsoft guy. So that framework we called as Azure SDK. So what is, as you already, I think you would be working in a .NET, right? We have a lot of frameworks. So we'll be consuming the classes of the framework and we'll be interacting or building an application. When you use on a platform as a service or a software as a service, right, Azure builds this predefined framework, which is nothing but using this framework, I'm going to consume those services kind of thing. For example, take blob or table storage that we have in Azure. So they'll be using this SDK, we'll be coding and accessing those things of information, and pushing and reading would be done through this, only through this SDK. So before going to Azure, right, so you need to decide what are the various options that you have currently. So, and going to the different segregations that I said, right, these are the various service providers across, apart from Azure, as you can see here. So Amazon and Cisco, each and every big company has their own cloud to be hosted, actually. So this ends my the basic in information on thing. And now we can start, like, what's your expectation from now? So where, which part are you looking at more, either the coding part or the admin side of that?
Yeah, hi. Raja, basically my requirement is to migrate the entire data services from on-prem to cloud.
Okay.
Currently, I'll tell you what is the situation. The situation is I have a data warehouse which is a very huge, around 22 to 25 TB data
are there.
Okay.
Daily, we are generating approximately 25 GB data.
And, okay.
The warehouse is messed up completely.
Okay.
So what it is running in the Oracle, and we have a local tool for ETL and reporting.
Okay.
So what we are doing, we are trying to streamline the entire process by bringing.
Okay. Hello. Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah.
I was put on mute. So.
Okay.
From where? Till what time? Till which point you were with me?
So you're talking about your system that is having a 25 GB of data which has been generated.
Not 25 GB, it's a TB, terabyte.
Okay, terabytes. So 25 yeah. terabytes generated every day. Okay.
Yeah. So what we are trying, it is completely messed up. I mean, it's very, very messed up situation. So,
okay.
In order to, and the problem is, we are generating approximately 25 to 30 GB data per day.
Okay.
GB.
Okay.
So, we don't have a space to bring the another rack.
Okay.
So that we can just create more spaces in the Oracle database. I mean,
okay.
There are some
limitations related
from yes.
Yeah.
So we wanted to move to the Azure, primarily
okay.
Azure SQL and Data Lake, which is combination of SQL and NoSQL database.
Okay.
So
okay.
That's where I need a training and
okay.
Migration of on-prem application to the Azure
okay.
data. The data is in Oracle. I have to migrate into the.
Actually, there for your problem, right? There are two cases. Actually, means what I meant to say is there, right? So one is creating a virtual machine in Azure, and
yeah.
you'll be so using that virtual machine, right? You'll be using just as in a one system that you have in Azure. And you'll be taking license of Oracle, and you'll be pushing those items into using some data packs or backpacks. You'll be but backpacks will be a lot heavier because, as you said, 2 terabytes, right? It will be taking more time.
No, not 2 terabytes. It's a 20, almost 25 terabytes.
Yeah, yeah, that's what I meant to say. It's a large data, so that would be not an solution. Second thing is, right, Microsoft provides an interface for importing the data from local to cloud, actually.
Yep.
So once you create a SQL server, right, there'll be some configurations. Like, it doesn't need much knowledge of Azure in that things. If you say how just what you do is, right, you'll just have one UI where you'll be selecting whatever will be database, and the Azure itself take cares of importing all the things into your Azure SQL premises.
Mm-hmm.
And coming to the second part, what you're talking about, so you said non-logistic data, right? I mean, unstructured data that we have. So basically, we have two major things that for that. One is called mm-hmm. table storage, which is used
yep.
for non-relationship database. That's the more on that, actually. If you're these things, right, probably I'll look into, because I now work from the migration perspective, because I used to more work on the SQL perspective, where we used to import from local to local SQL to the cloud. But as you said, your requirement, right, as it's from Oracle. So I need to go through a few articles before coming back to you saying that, so how it could be done.
Okay. Okay.
Because I never worked in that side, so a friend,
it's
I cannot say that.
Actually, it's
yeah.
very rare scenario. And, so actually, what my management is deciding, or they are about to decide, that,
okay.
To get rid of Oracle.
Okay.
And maintaining everything in the Microsoft.
Yeah, I understand your like a problem actually. That's what I meant to say. Means before suggesting you anything, I also need to do some background work.
Yeah, that's okay. That's okay.
To see what are the feasibilities for every approach, right? There'll be different ways, but we need to decide which is the best way to us with the minimal of effects efforts that we're going to keep.
Correct.
So that's the reason I told like I need a couple of at least couple of days to come back to you. Like we can go by X procedure or Y procedure, and then we can debate like which would be a better option for us to do this.
Okay.
So that's what I meant to say. Or I could provide an a complete solution also if it's possible to do the entire thing. But as you're sensitive data, right, we need to also think about the data losses. Data losses should not be happening from one from the imports and everything. So that's the reason. Give me a couple of days. Probably, as I said, right, I never worked in Oracle migration. So maybe I need to speak a couple of guys who has Oracle experience, and then I could say you this would be the approach that we can use, or this good approach. Then we can decide the course structure. Like what to do, and if it's possible, I'll provide a detailed document on it, saying that how, what are the steps that you're going to do for importing all the stuff.
Okay. Okay. This is something which can be. I mean, you can take your time. I understand the situation because it's a very rare and different scenario. But overall, what are the the content of the course, of this course, which
that's what. Yeah, as you're looking on a migration part, right? That's what I meant to say. There are a lot of softwares, like a lot of services that are provided through Azure. Actually, give you the basic, most. I can cover the most basics of what Azure development would be there. So if you're looking more in admin section, then there is one more person who is going to take you the class regarding the admin section. Admin sections are nothing but whatever the work you're talking about, like importing the files, maintaining the servers. And I would be dealing more on the consuming the services kind of thing.
What does it mean in general? Because, you know, I'll tell you my background, why I can't understand most of the time terminology. Because I have been, started my career as a CRM developer, Siebel primarily. I was working as a Siebel developer long time back. And then since last 3-4 years, I'm into the data warehouse. Here I'm working as a data warehouse developer, comprising the warehouse, the ETL, and then generating some kind of report. So you have to be slightly the terminologies are pretty different for me, and I never dealt with some of these concepts.
So I'll tell, before speaking it right, I'll tell you my experience also. So I'm mainly a Microsoft developer, where primarily I worked in web applications actually. So most of my exposure comes on like the various cloud services that are available, like as you already spoke with the SQL Azure, and like storage kind of thing, which we always say, said you right, like sharing the physical network folders. Like you'll be creating them on virtual folder in cloud. So consuming those for development, and the various services like blob, table storage, and MSN queue, and all this stuff are there, right? My primary exposure comes in there, like creating a SQL and maintaining the SQL kind of thing. What I'm talking about the second part is, right, as you worked in your organization, right, there'll be always hardware guys, networking guys, where they'll be setting the cloud, and they are the deciders how much the CV of RAM, and even they write some PowerShell scripting for that to automatically generate and all the stuff that comes into the admin part of the your portal. Means you'll be not responsible to do all the stuff. There'll be one guy who'd be doing all the admin works. Like, mm-hmm. if you want an SQL server, right? You'll be having an SQL server. If you want to have an virtual machine, right? He'll be the guy to do the virtual machine. But to create a virtual machine, right, you can do it from PowerShell, or you can do it from UI, or you can do it from code bases, actually.
Right.
So my more exposure comes on the coding side of that. For example, consuming the services of SQL, consuming the service of Blob, or the various PaaS items, which are platform as a service, which I already spoke, right? Like Microsoft provides various platform as a services. My exposure only comes for that side.
Okay.
Consuming the platform. But your requirement is mostly for the infrastructure of the services, where your hardware team would decide like what configuration is going to run, how the imports is going to work, done from one server to other server, which I have a only little bit of exposure. I'm not a great on that. That's the reason I was saying, right? I need to contact the other guy who deals it. But seeing your requirement is like you need more an infrastructure guy rather than a development guy, because it's when it comes to migration, right? The infrastructure guy decides how to migrate.
Exactly, and you are you taking the course on Azure SQL?
No, it's Azure SQL is one of the past like future it provides, but they are. Lot of things in Azure, as I already showed, right? I can send you those details also, like table storage, cloud storage, and web hosting, and all the stuff. My more exposure comes in that area, like how you do your host in your application in that. Like how do you create a SQL server, and how do you consume it? And how do you create a blob or table storage, and how you consume your blob or table using the code in your applications? So my course would be more on that, but per seeing your requirement, yours is in the opposite way. It will be having more on admin section, like as your already system is set up, right? You're importing that system to the cloud.
Yeah, that's right.
So you need exposure more on the infrastructure admin side rather than the coding side.
That's right.
So that's the reason I'm saying. Maybe you, as your requirement, right? I may not be a better person to give a solution to you, because I'm not much better than that. Because I'm more familiar with the past.
Right. Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Okay.
That's reason I'm asking. Just give me a couple of days. So, I need to group up with a couple of people and assist you saying that. So this is going to be your course content. These are the and we can also provide a sample solution for moving some like 1 GB or thing importing from Oracle to SQL and those things
correct
so you can replicate the same steps to the your premises as I said data loss is a very big thing which
correct
we cannot bear actually
it is a kind of biggest hospitality industry.
Okay.
Biggest hospitality industry in the Australia and New Zealand, and we are the only casino
providers,
casino service provider in the entire region. So that there are thousands of machines, and they generate a lot of data. So that's the reason the rate of data generation is quite huge compared to the other industry vertical.
Yeah.
And that's the reason data are so important. Plus there are
even I work in banking sector currently, so
I know the
sensitivity of the information that is going to leak or import actually.
Right.
So
right.
How bigger violations would be going on if one bit of sensitive data also leaks. That's the reason I keep more cautious on the data imports, because losing the data means almost losing your career.
Exactly. Not only career, I mean, fine and company is such a huge.
That's what I'm saying. The company reputation, everything depends upon your solution.
Yes, that's so right.
That's the reason I'm saying I can understand, like, what's your expectation kind of thing?
Yeah.
Sorry. They said there is a rabbit here.
Hey, hi.
No, it's not. Someone okay. came to my house, actually.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
It's okay. That's what, maybe that's what, I don't say I'm the right person, but mm-hmm. as I know your sensitive volume, right?
Yeah.
I don't want to keep a new also in risk, so I need to
Correct.
Speak a couple of people.
Yes,
and
please.
Then we would be deciding like what would be your course content, all this.
Yeah.
As I said, right, your requirement is more on infrastructure as a service rather than like creating a infrastructure for your organization. Hello.
Yeah. Carry
yeah,
on.
Yeah.
Somewhere
yeah.
I lost in between.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, that's what I'm saying. Your more requirement is on admin section, so I'll mm-hmm. be catching a guy who has more expertise on that, and
yeah.
We will be coming back to you. But
yeah, sure.
If you also want to have like more knowledge on the like services which are provided, maybe we can take that a later part of our course, based
yeah.
on your
yeah, that's
requirement.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
No,
I think
once we get associated, then the comfort level would be more, and then we
yes.
can think of leveraging onto the other things which is having, which is available with you. So
yeah,
that's
sure.
right.
So I think we can drop for the day. I think we'll be
Correct.
Communicating you back regarding
yeah.
the dates and the course content again. So
yeah.
based on it, we can decide it in our later sessions, actually.
Yeah. Great.
Yeah. Thanks, man. Thanks for your time.
Yeah, thanks,
so,
Raja.
I'll be
Thank you.
It
was pretty nice
yeah.
talking to you. Yeah. Expect
yeah.
to talk to you more in the coming days.
Yeah, sure.
Okay,
thanks. Again.
Have a nice
thanks.
Weekend.
Bye.
Thanks.
Yeah,
Bye.
Same to you. Bye.
Yeah.